Armed and Victorious Morning Prayer Warriors in Christ, grace and peace to you. Welcome to our fifth day of Dawn Watch, and the prime prayer focus for this day is on the fulfillment of God's greatest commandment and the Great Commission. I want to start this short exhortation with this question for us to ponder. What has God placed you in this earth to do? What is your purpose? What drives you? What are you living for? Very simple. As believers, our purpose is going across the street or across the globe, is to love God and to love others. Or let's put this way, to know God and to make Him known. Jesus Christ has given two important tasks for His people. The first one is the great commandment, loving God with all our heart and mind, and loving neighbors as ourselves, found in Matthew 22, verses 37 to 39. The second one is the great commission, preaching the gospel and making disciples all around the world, found in Matthew 28, verses 18 to 20. These two commandments guide a Christian's response to humans' personal, emotional, and most especially spiritual need. These two are essential and connected to each other. In fact, we cannot do one without doing the other. John Piper is noted as saying in his famous book, "Let the nations be glad that our fuel and passion for missions should be driven by God's fuel and passion for mission, which is His own glory." How then is it that we make His glory our primary focus? Jesus Himself says that we must first love. Loving God, as the greatest commandment means, we love by getting to know Him as supreme, taking time to study His attributes, which is He is our creator in Genesis, a covenant keeping in Genesis chapter 12, our deliverer in Exodus, holy in Revelation chapter 4, omnipotent in Jeremiah chapter 32. He's the love itself in 1 John 4, 7 to 10, the sovereign God in 1 Chronicles 29, and the Father in Romans 8, 15 to 17. It also means to revisit the gospel in our lives and taking time to recount how God has brought us from death to life, darkness to light, and enemies to sons. Loving God means studying His word and praying. God has given us His word in order that we might know Him. And He has given us access to Him through prayer and spending time each day, deepening that relationship with Him. Let us ask ourselves this question. How infused is the gospel in my life? Am I growing in the knowledge and love for God daily? What passions do I need to realign in order to make God first? As we get to know and love God more intimately, we in turn see others differently and learn to love them with the love that comes from God alone. Share the gospel of salvation with them and let them fall at His feet and glorify Him. In loving others, we know that as sinners, we fail at this daily. But as those who had been redeemed, should see this verse in 1 John 3:16 differently. By this we know love, that He laid down His life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives from the brothers, because of the rich love that God has poured out on us as His children. We must exhibit this same sort of love in loving others. God is love, and love comes from God. Loving God results in loving people. 1 John chapter 4, verses 20 to 21 tell us plainly, if anyone says, "I love God," and hate his brother, he is a liar and did not see God. It is natural to wonder which people we are supposed to love. In Luke chapter 10, an expert in religious law questioned Jesus about how to live out this great commandment. He wanted to know who exactly Jesus meant when He commanded us to love your neighbor. "Who is my neighbor?" asked the lawyer. Jesus answered by sharing the parable of the Good Samaritan, which teaches that anyone who crosses your path and has need is your neighbor. Then Jesus changed the question. The key question according to Jesus is not, "Who is my neighbor?" but "Who is a good neighbor?" In the parable, it was the Samaritan who reached out and helped. It was the Samaritan who saw the need and moved toward the needy person. It was the Samaritan who gave what he had to help the person in need. He approached and embraced the person, whereas the other characters in the story retreated. Love makes the difference. love that manifested itself in compassion and mercy. Consider how you view people and relationship. Do you see the people around you, at work, school, or in a coffee shop as people? Or do you see them as those who have been created in the image of God? Do you take time to consider their needy condition, a need of a friend and a savior? Let us allow the gospel to transform the way that we tangibly love others. Let us not see people and relationship as another thing to get done in the list of tasks throughout the day. Pray that as your love for God deepens, your love for others might be stretched to display, demonstrate, and declare the gospel. Matthew 28, 18 to 20 is a section of scripture known as the Great Commission. It was the last recorded personal directive of Jesus to his disciples, and it holds great significance to all followers of Christ. How many mission-focused sermons have we listened to where Matthew chapter 28, verses 18 to 20 has been the focal passages? This is not a bad thing, but we must not limit the scope of how this passage to be rightly applied. The Great Commission is more than just reaching those with the gospel who have yet to hear. It is also teaching them to obey all that Christ has commanded. Sharing the gospel and seeing people come to faith is the only beginning. We must then teach, train, and equip them to live as disciples of Christ. What is a disciple? A disciple is one who denies self, takes up his cross, and follows after Christ. A disciple is a lifelong apprentice of Jesus who in community follows Jesus, becomes like Jesus, does what Jesus did, and helps others do the same. As we follow the great commandment in loving God more deeply, we'll follow him more passionately. Here, as believers in Christ, we should always have someone pouring into us, and we should always be pouring into others. Look at how Jesus did it. He had a crowd who followed him in Mark chapter 8. He had a 70 in Luke 10. He had a 12 in Matthew 10. The 3 in Matthew 17. And he had a 1 in John 13 verses 23. We should in turn have those different spheres of influence and impact in our own lives. We will have our own crowd. It might be your workplace. The 70 are those whom we know somewhat closer, like division within work or in a party or a class. The 12 even closer, like your extended families. The 3 still even closer, like your family itself. And then the 1 which is your closest person, wife, child, or close friend. Are we investing and fulfilling in each of the levels of disciple making? Or just reaching but teaching to observe? In the Great Commission, Jesus calls every Christian to step out in faith and spread the good news. It is faith in action. People who obey this command change their spiritual lives forever. It could be spreading the good news to a neighbor or moving to another country to reach the people there. It could be sharing with less fortunate kids down the street, or spreading the word in a town 2 hours away. Wherever we go, every faithful Christian is compelled through obedience to share the gospel. Who has God put in your heart to share the gift of salvation? What steps did you take to make disciples of all nations? Where should you be sending? Does Jesus specify the place? Fortunately, he does. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations. All nations. Not some nations, not even one nation, but all nations. This includes people groups, language group, ethnicities, religious blocks, geopolitical nations, states, all of it. Since none are excluded from the authority of Christ, none are exempted from the need for the gospel. As we seek to spread the good news of the kingdom, we may find wondering which of Jesus' two most important commands we should give the most emphasis. The Great Commission or the Great Commandment. But can one truly exist without the other? The Great Commission and the Great Commandment must be held together in one thought. Because we love God, we love people. As we love people the way we love God, we will engage in making disciples. The two go together and make the journey simple, not complicated. Jesus did it. He seamlessly joined the Great Commandment and the Great Commission. He forgave the sins of the repentant and feed the hungry. the word of God and healed the sick and demon-possessed. He challenged his hearers to full discipleship and restored the only son back to a grieving mother. He reached out to the unreached people group with a promise of a well of water that would never run dry. Our ministries may emphasize one area more than another due to gifting and ministry focus. However, as a whole, which is the Christ body, and that is the church, must continue to display to the world the holistic gospel. Christ's love expressed in all dimensions, towards human need and towards a lost spiritual condition. Our motive drives our mission. Our passion fuels our priorities. Our heart energizes our hands. Loving God and loving people is our motive. Making disciples who can make disciples is our mission. Throughout Jesus' ministry, he modeled what it means to love God and love people. And through his priorities, he made disciples who can make disciples also. Then, in his final words to his disciples, including you and me, summarized his mission and handed it off to us to complete. A blessed morning to all.